Welcome to Bible Month and 30 Days with Colossians. Our first week's study is led by Mike Fogg, a local preacher in the Chelmsford circuit from South Woodham Ferrers.
Hello, I'm Mike and I'm going to step you through the first 23 verses of Paul's letter to the Colossians. I'm going to do six things during this presentation. Firstly, I'm going to look at the background to Paul's letter to the Colossians. That'll be followed by looking at the greeting that Paul uses to the people at Colossae. Then there's an opening prayer. Paul uses an opening prayer and we'll look at that. Interestingly, in the study text, the next section is referred to as the Christ hymn, in inverted commas. We'll look at that, and I've actually put a question mark behind that name. The last part of the text that we're going to look at is, in fact, three verses dealing with reconciliation and response. Then the final thing is going to be me setting, or not setting really, but me proposing six questions for us to discuss when we look at this on the Zoom call later this week. Firstly then, let's look at the background to Paul's letter to the Colossians. Firstly, Colossae is an insignificant place. It is now, it was then. It's in the Lycus Valley, about 100 miles from Ephesus, where Paul spent 2 years teaching. And if you look on Google Maps, you'll notice that the main road goes above it. So the main road doesn't even go through it. It's in the middle of nowhere. Its nearest town is a place called Denizli, and that's in western Turkey. We believe that Paul didn't actually ever visit Colossae. However, in Acts chapter 19 verse 10, there is a statement about people from Asia having come to Paul and become Christians. And one of the sources that I looked at to help me with this talk suggested that Philemon and Epaphras actually went there, met Paul and became Christians. It's clear that Paul knew Philemon personally because when he writes the letter to Philemon, he speaks of him as a friend. And he addresses him as a friend and he asks him for a favour. As far as we know, the church in Colossae was probably started between 55 and 60 AD by Epaphras and Philemon. And it appears to contain a mixture of Jews and Gentiles. So why on earth did Paul write a letter to this small church in an out-of-the-way place in the middle of nowhere? The answer seems to have been that he wrote the letter whilst he was under house arrest in Rome, and news had come to him from Epaphras, and possibly news from someone called Onesimus, that there was trouble back at the church. Others were trying to turn the heads of the Christians, and Paul wanted to warn the Christians about their spiritual well-being. Onesimus also forms an interesting link to the letter of Philemon, assuming it's the same Onesimus who's mentioned later in this letter. We think this letter was written between AD 60 and 61, when Paul was under house arrest in Rome. It was certainly written before Colossae was destroyed by an earthquake. Let's move on and look at the opening of the letter. And first of all, the greeting from Paul to the people at Colossae. Now, when we started the letter today, we might say, well, dear so-and-so. Or we might start an email by saying, hi, Peter. If it's a text message, we jump straight in and start typing. The convention at the time that Paul was writing was that the writer started the letter by saying who was writing it, and secondly, started by giving their credentials for actually writing about the subject. So You know, what right did they have to talk about so-and-so in the letter? Paul, therefore, follows this convention and he starts the letter with a greeting. And I'm going to read it. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God and our brother Timothy. Now, you might think that's a fairly okay way to start a letter. But let's look again at what's actually being said here. What's actually being said by Paul is that he is the one that's clothed with the authority and endowed with the power of the sender. And who's the sender? The sender's Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So all of a sudden, this letter becomes a lot more important. Timothy is, of course, a brother, not an apostle, and he's distinguished in that way. Paul doesn't start all his letters this way. If you want to compare how this letter starts with, say, Thessalonians and Philippians, look at the start of, well, I've picked Thessalonians. Look at the start of Thessalonians. It says, from Paul, Silas and Timothy to the church of the Thessalonians. And it's concluded that when Paul's writing and he wants to emphasise the origin and the weight of what he's going to say and what authority is invested in him, he gives it full throttle. In the words that we found in Colossians. Where there's a close bond of friendship in Philippians or Thessalonians, or in the letter to Philemon, where Paul is asking a favour, he doesn't start in this way. Another comparison will be to look at the letter that's written to the Galatians. Look at Galatians 1:1. And Paul really, really emphasises his authority and his power there. From all of this, we can conclude then that at the very start of this letter, Paul has got concerns to make. And those concerns are going to come during the rest of the text. In verses 3 to 6, Paul congratulates and he flatters the Colossians. He uses the analogy of a plant bearing fruit. So they have brought others to know Jesus. He's heard great things about how they saved souls. And the faith that they exhibit draws its vitality from Christ. And this Christian example is bringing others to know and want to know Jesus. Finally here we learn that Epaphras has taught them all that they know and that he is their minister. Verses 9 to 14 are the next part of the letter to look at. And this is Paul's opening prayer. And what we have here is a prayer of intercession on behalf of the Colossians. In saying, for this reason, at the start of verse 9, Paul highlights the very congratulations that we talked about a few minutes ago. And that leads him to intercede for them further. They are doing well and he wants them to do better. He wants them filled with knowledge of God's will, which is fundamental to moral and spiritual growth. This growth will lead to the faith to do good works. And of course, the study text reminds us that good works on their own are not a replacement for faith. There's a hint in verse 11 that tells us that we are not to expect everything to go smoothly. For we will need great endurance and patience. Now I'm talking to you and I wrote the text that's being circulated to others who can't join the Zoom calls in early October 2020. Now at the moment there are great rumblings up and down the country. Liverpool has just been put into lockdown. Other places may go. Pubs are shutting at 10 o'clock. Pubs may not open in some places. Wales has restricted travel. And even the French have shut the bars and cafes. Many Christians have faced much more testing times than us over the centuries. And many people today face much worse situations with the coronavirus than we do. But I looked up a commentary and looked at verse 11 here and found two interesting things. In effect, this verse says that no matter how wide the demand on our Christian service may be, or how difficult by human standards it may be to do what we need to do, God will support us and support us and give us the divine resources to match the need as it appears. That's the first thing. The second thing, and I'm sure you all know this, that the Greek word used for strengthening in verse 11 doesn't mean a one-off shot of strength, as when we had a booster injection. It speaks of a continuous provision of resources. So then if we paraphrase Winston Churchill, whatever the tools we need to finish the job, those tools are there for us again and again and again. In verse 12, Paul moves on to talk about Peter's experience on the rooftop, where all sorts of creatures came down to him and he was asked to eat them. That led Peter and the apostles to understand that the message of Jesus was for everyone, for all men and women from all countries around the world, and that God wanted everyone to become children of light. In its concluding comments about this part of the text, the study text that we've been given to look at speaks of realised eschatology. Ooh, don't be frightened. I thought I knew what it was, but I couldn't have given you a definition for it. So I started to do some detective work. And where better to start than the Encyclopaedia Britannica? So the Encyclopaedia Britannica online says that eschatology is, and I'm going to have to read it, the doctrine of the last things. It was originally a Western term referring to Jewish, Christian or Muslim beliefs about the end of history, the resurrection of the dead, the last judgment, the messianic era and other things that happened at that time. So eschatology is about the end of time, and typical eschatological language uses two elements together. It speaks of the negation of the negative and an analogy of the future. So the negation of the negative means that bad things are going to stop at some time in the future. And if we look at Revelation chapter 21 verse 4, we find it says, "He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. The old order of things has passed away." So at the end of time, Jesus will take all the pain, all the suffering, all the bad things away. Fine. Now my detective work moved on because we needed to actually look at what the word realised meant in this context. I understand that C.H. Dodd, in a 1935 book, The Parables of the Kingdom, looked into this and created this sort of view of realised eschatology. I looked for a definition and found one on a website called gotquestions.org. And it's this: realised eschatology is a theory holding that prophetic passages in the New Testament do not refer to the future, rather they refer to the ministry of Jesus and his lasting legacy to the church. According to realised eschatology, all of the prophecies in the Bible about the kingdom were fulfilled during Jesus' time. I find realized better if I can substitute the word fulfilled for it. So I would talk of fulfilled eschatology. And then if we look at Mark chapter 1 verse 15, that records Jesus as saying, the time has come, the kingdom of God has come near, repent and believe the good news. So advocates of realized eschatology would say that what Jesus was saying was that the kingdom came there then with him at that time. And so when Jesus cast out a demon or touched a lame person and healed them, that theory says that heaven touched earth. Now others would say that Jesus taught unrealized eschatology, because there are many things that are promised in the Bible that have not yet been fulfilled. And we trust in God for being faithful to bring them about. As I understand it, there's no right or wrong. I do believe that Jesus was from heaven, and heaven touched earth when Jesus touched and healed people. But equally, I wait for Jesus to return and sweep us all up and end pain and suffering. Let's go back to Colossians then. That was the diversion. Advocates of realized eschatology would say that because the Colossians were rescued and then they were brought into God's kingdom, that the kingdom of God had arrived with them at that time, then and there. And if you follow that through logically, then we as believers and practicing Christians are part of God's kingdom on earth today. The next part of the text that we've got to deal with is verses 15 to 20. That's called the Christ hymn in the study text. I have to say that the term Christ hymn doesn't grab me, and that's why I followed it with a question mark. And the study text itself refers to the term Christ hymn as being an open question. The NIV has the title The Supremacy of Christ for this element of the text. And one of the commentaries I looked at to help me prepare for today has the subheading The Preeminence of Christ. And it's this last phrase, the preeminence of Christ, that sits best with me. You may see differently, and again, I don't think there's a right or wrong about it. Going back to the concept of a hymn though, if you want a hymn for this text, then it doesn't get better than Charles Wesley's Ye Servants of God, Your Master Proclaim, and Publish Abroad His Wonderful Name, the name all victorious of Jesus extol, His Kingdom is glorious, and rules over all. That's from our hymn book number 314. I did think of singing it for you, but I thought that everyone would switch off if I tried to do that. But more seriously, irrespective of what you call this passage, it's got something absolutely vital to tell us. Frequently, and naturally perhaps, we think of Jesus, or we think of the person of Jesus, as the one we hear about in the Gospels, the one who's around Galilee, the one who came from Nazareth, the one who preached and taught for those 3 years when he was physically on earth. But it's more than that. Now, why are you sitting comfortably? Because an enormous revelation is going to wing its way down to us. For in verse 15 of this passage, it's revealed to us that it's the Son of God in his eternal being who is being described here. The one who was with God before creation. Now this is an enormous revelation. It's the same Jesus, but our minds wouldn't automatically think of Jesus being there at the time before creation. We're used to thinking of the Jesus as he appeared on earth. Preeminence means the fact of surpassing all others. Superiority. And it's the preeminent Christ that Paul is speaking of in verse 15. The Christ, the Son of God, who was there before and during creation. He's there today and he's there tomorrow. He created all things that are visible and invisible. By visible, perhaps Paul means things that we can see around us on earth, things that we can see in space. By invisible, perhaps Paul means things that are in heaven. Now to invisible and invisible, I think we can add discovered and undiscovered. Think about the things that have been discovered and developed since this letter was written in AD 61. Think about the things that are not yet discovered. What they may be. How we may be able to develop them for the benefit of mankind. And what this letter is saying is that Jesus was the one who created all of those. This, of course, is a precursor to the first 18 verses of John's Gospel. We start with, "In the beginning was the Word." And the study text explains its use of this sort of language by saying that it would have been recognised by Jewish people at the time as being language relating to divine wisdom and the Word. But if people thought about this today, it will blow their minds. Verse 18 moves us on to a different tack. In fact, it has two tacks. "For we learn that this preeminent Son of God, who was there before creation, is the head of his body, the church." Now here Paul is making reference to what he wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 to 24, where we learn that the body has many parts. Some are glamorous, some are unglamorous. Yet the body needs all of those parts to function, if it is to be functioning successfully as God intended it. And so the church of God, the church of Christ, has got glamorous jobs. Woo-hoo, standing at the front preaching. And unglamorous jobs, cleaning the toilets. And we need to recognise everybody in our church who does glamorous jobs, unglamorous jobs. All are equal in Christ. All are important. If the Church of Christ is to function as God wants it to, then all of those parts must be functioning. So we don't have any truck with all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others. That is not part of a Christian belief. Also in verse 18 of Colossians, Paul speaks of Jesus' resurrection. He recognises Jesus as the firstborn from amongst the dead. And this tells us that the resurrected Jesus, the first to emerge victorious over death, can be given the title, the source of life. The head of the church therefore leads his followers, glamorous and unglamorous, to life after death. And in that situation, in that case, Jesus is supreme. Now we are used to the term the body of Christ as standing for the worldwide church. in all its different forms, in all its different ways of worship, in all its different places. But just think about how that would have appeared to the people who this letter was originally written to. They only just accepted Gentiles. Or, if they were Gentiles, they had only just been accepted into the Christian community. But through all of this, the linkage is secure. The head of the church is the resurrected Jesus. And the twiddly bits who are to do his work on earth are you and me. And you and me will live, you and me will die, and you and me will be in Jesus' house where there are many rooms, and we will live forever with him. Verses 19 and 20 pack another significant message into this letter, that reconciliation is possible through Jesus' act of redemption. The last part of the text that we've got to look at today is verses 21 to 23. And the subtitle for those is Reconciliation and Response. Now, if I was writing this letter, I might have been tempted to weave in the idea that we were once alienated, as described in verse 21, back before verse 19 and verse 20. So that we could say that we were lost, and through Jesus' redemptive action, we were found. But who am I to make such comments? I think we could sum up verses 20 to 22 in a long single sentence, which I'm going to read for you. We could say that Jesus, who created, maintains, and rules over the universe, came to earth, lived with us, showed us the way, died for us to allow us to be at peace with God and to make us morally holy in God's sight. And that paragraph is a sermon on its own. So that's all of the things I've got to say. That's the good news that we've heard, that we continue to hear. It's from Paul. It's what Paul wrote. It's what Paul died for and what many others have died for. The question is, what's our response? Will we give our lives to live the way that Paul wants us to live? And so to some things to think about for the Zoom discussion. There are three questions in the study text. They are, firstly, have we lost something? Have we lost something important in the often very casual greetings that we use in letters? And I've added letters, emails, instant messages and WhatsApps, if you like. In those communications to our friends, have we actually lost something important by being too casual? Secondly, how important is it that we pray for one another? Third question is, does the hymn of praise to Christ, what they call the Christ hymn, does that tell us something about Christ that we don't usually think about? Or is it over the top? Now, I've added three questions which you might like to think about, or you might have other things you want to discuss when we go into the Zoom meeting. What have we got to do to exhibit the faith that draws its vitality from Christ himself? Remember, that was what Paul said the Colossians had. Next, how can we inject some vitality, perhaps I should say, vitality into the local body of Christ in November 2020. And finally, what do you feel about those terms realised and unrealised eschatology? Well, as I say, that's all, folks. Thanks for listening, and I look forward to seeing you on the Zoom call where we can talk more about this first tranche of the letter to the Colossians.